Hello everyone, good morning. My name is Eric Payard and I am delighted to participate to this Global Food Security and Sustainability Summit. I have been working in the feed industry for almost 30 years, engineer and agriculture. Starting as a swine nutritionist, I have been involved in sales, marketing and business management for many years, and today I am the managing director for IDCO for the Asia Pacific region. I will focus my presentation on a very large topic, which is feeding the planet for a better future. It means try to give you an overview of the main challenges our industry is currently facing and will face during the next decades to feed the worldwide population and how the feed additives industry can support, bring value and technologies to limit our impact on the environment. First of all, let me introduce IDCO and its position in the feed and food value chain. Feed are produced to fulfill animal requirements with raw materials from vegetable production, such as grains, corn, wheat, protein sources, mainly soybean meal, but also fish meals, co-products, vegetable oils, and premixes, which contain minerals, vitamins, and trace elements, and other feed additives. Animal feeds will be transformed by poultry, swine, ruminants, or aqua species to produce meat, eggs, or milk that will be finally processed in different foodstuffs. IDCO is a leading company, 100% focused on feed industry, producing and selling products that will be incorporated in feeds to provide benefits at different stages. Improving the nutritional value of raw materials, get same performance for animal at better cost, having a positive impact on the environment, and providing better health of animals when facing stressful conditions. We act everywhere in the world with a turnover of about $1.8 billion in 2020. Our vision is to provide healthy, sustainable, affordable and high quality food. With innovative products and services, we play our part in the sustainable development of our world. Feeding the world, what does it mean concretely? Everyone agrees that the worldwide population will keep growing and the growth forecast may reach about 10 billion people in 2050. And most of them, about 60%, will be located in Asia. The continuous growing population will drive a stronger demand for meat. Today, the more developed countries, US, Latin America and Europe, which are going to represent 23% of the worldwide population, have the higher meat consumption per capita, more than 80 kilos per year. This is the top countries on the slide that you show that you can see right now. They have the higher meat consumption and they may stabilize their consumption. They may slightly reduce or switch to more sustainable production, but it will certainly remain at a high level. In the US, for instance, we see a reduction of consumption for the beef meat, hamburgers, but a clear increase for poultry, chicken processed meat, and the meat consumption stay higher than 100 kilo per capita per year. On the other hand, developing countries, Africa, Asia, we have a low consumption, will be keen to get more meat, and we clearly see an upward trend, which is basically linked to a higher gross domestic product or income expected to increase for the next decades. Hopefully, the demand for chicken meat will increase faster. You see on the slide here the poultry meat consumption by country. So this demand will increase faster and should have a positive impact compared to other species. Indeed, poultry and aqua species have the best feed conversion ratio to produce meat. You can see on the right hand side of the slide that to produce 1 kilo of pork meat, you need almost two times more feed than for poultry. And for 1 kilo of beef, you need four times more feed than for poultry. So aqua and poultry meat, which are already the most important source of protein for humans, will increase their share of wallet in the near future. The drivers for higher meat consumption are clear. Population and income growth, social recognition, urbanization, affordability. We also have some potential breaks, which are on one hand for developing countries. We know that some of them have fragile economies, and we may have some question about the GDP growth. And on the other hand, mainly for developed countries, we see an escalation of the anti-meat lobby activities and an increase of interest for alternative source of meat, cultured meat, for instance, without forgetting more and more concerns for animal well-being, fueling vegetarian and flexitarian behaviors. However, today, everyone agree and say that demand drivers will be stronger than potential breaks. And the Food and Agriculture Organization of United Nations recently confirmed that the world meat production is projected to double in 2050. And this is the chart that you have on the right-hand side. I also propose you a slide with a rough estimation and a simple calculation to visualize this statement. The meat consumption in 2020 was 315 million tons for an average of about 42 kilo per capita. If we only consider the growing population, it will mean more than 400 million tons in 2050, which is already 30% more than today. If you assume that the meat consumption will keep growing globally, and if we take a low pace of only 1.5% per year, it will mean a worldwide consumption of about 66 kilo per capita. It is still far from the standard of developed country, above 80, but it will mean a consumption of more than 630 million tons, confirming the double consumption forecasted by the FAO. What are going to be the consequences? Do we have the resources and technology to make it done? What option could be considered? The following flowchart done by Stellarix Consistency Services represents the summary of various challenges in the food system and respective starting point for the policies which can be made to achieve sustainability. We can see the difficult balance between an increased demand for crops for animal feed and the risk to have a lower production and availability due to the climate change, water scarcity, and the decline in crop yields. It clearly shows the absolute necessity to put in place sustainable actions in various sections: sustainable livestock and aquaculture, sustainable agriculture, and sustainable feed. For animal nutrition, the need for improvements and options available are well known. We are here in the center of the slide, a non-exhaustive list of needs for being more sustainable. Maximize feed conversion to reduce the use of cereal crops and proteins. Optimization of animal performances, which is linked to genetics, well-being, and farm management. Optimization of animal nutrition with a better balance between needs and supply to reduce waste. Reduce environmental impact from livestock, mainly nitrogen and phosphorus excretion. Sustainable use of resources, and also some concern from the consumer, which is to get high quality meat protein at low cost and antibiotic-free meat. So many needs, but we have several options already existing, such as genetic improvement, precise nutrition, feed additive strategy, and precision livestock farming, that I am going to detail in the next slide. Hopefully, our industry is working on this topic since decades, and we have already many options which are in place. And we will see that we still have some room for further improvements. Genetic is a very important leverage. As an example, on the left-hand side, you can see the improvement done with the birds, allowing a much better feed efficiency. They grow faster, bigger, and consume less feed. It means that the quantity of feed to produce 1 kilo of meat have been drastically reduced. I took poultry as an example, but we have the same trend with the swine industry on the feed conversion ratio and also on the productivity with more piglets produced by sow. Or for the dairy industry, with higher milk production per cow and a better milk quality with a higher protein content thanks to nutrition. On the bottom and right hand side, you see the evolution of the feed conversion for broilers. We have not reached yet the 1-to-1 ratio for poultry, which was forecasted in 2013, but we can still improve year by year, maximizing the genetic potential of animals thanks to nutrition and farm management. The second leverage is animal nutrition. Our industry is managing a considerable number of ingredients to balance the feed composition for all species and suit to animal requirements by stage for all nutrients. Nutrients mean energy, protein, fiber content, amino acid content, phosphorus, calcium, etc., etc. And this optimization is done at the least cost. The feed industry has an experience of more than 70 years to optimize the nutrition for all species, with hundreds of thousands of experiments, studies, and publications. In bracket, it is much more sophisticated and rationalized than nutrition for humans, where most of the people don't know how to balance their daily intake or do not have the possibility to do it. On this slide, you can see a few examples on how additives can contribute to a sustainable animal production. And I took as an example the range of services and products and solutions provided by Adiceo. So you have the strategies in green and the solution that we can provide to customers. The number one strategy is the reformulation of feed, which is commonly used by our customers. As an example, for amino acids in poultry, methionine is the first limiting amino acid to produce protein blocks by birds. If the industry doesn't use a feed grade methionine to reach animal requirements, it will need about 40 to 50% more soybean meal use, and the cost of the feed will be more expensive. And all amino acids provided in excess from the protein will be excreted in the manure and then in the environment. This is the same for the swine industry with lysine. So today, the current use of feed-grade synthetic amino acids and the availability of secondary amino acids such as threonine, tryptophan, valine, and others allow the feed industry to limit the protein content of their feed, reduce the use of soybean meal, and maintain animal performances at least cost. This is the same for enzymes, which improve the digestibility of ingredients such as polysaccharides, phytic phosphorus, or vegetable phosphorus, or protein contained in the raw materials. Xylanase or beta-glucanase allow animals to extract more energy from the cereals, wheat, barley, or corn. Then we can reduce the use of other energy sources, such as vegetable oils, and it has a positive impact on the land use. Many solutions exist as well for other strategies, such as improvement of nutrition efficiency, which will drive for a better feed conversion, or a strategy to reduce the excretion and reduce the emission of nitrogen and phosphorus, and also some specific ingredients that will have a positive impact on the animal health reducing mortality, or the use on antibiotics in the farms. To give you a concrete example, here is a study where the researchers did what we call a cradle to farm gate study using a life cycle assessment and evaluated the impact on the environment for a broiler production with or without food grade amino acids and phytase supplementation. The conclusions are very, very clear. With benefits on greenhouse gas emission, acidification, and we can see that the benefits are even higher for Europe than for North America and South America, because Europe today is importing soybean meal from US and Brazil. So we see here that the industry already have a positive impact thanks to the additives they use, which are available. And we see, and you will see that we can go further for getting more, more benefits. Many studies demonstrate the possibility to further decrease the protein content of feeds for poultry and swine without having an impact on the performance of the animal, which is very important. Here, you can see the reduction of 1% of crude protein contained in the feed, and it was quantified and published by the European Union Amino Acid Alliance. We see the reduction of the nitrogen excretion, and then the reduction of the use of soybean meal, and also the positive impact on animal health, reducing the pododermatitis and improving the gut health. We see that the reduction has also a direct positive impact on acidification, air quality, water quality, and the reduction of the eutrophication, production of algae linked to the high nitrogen content in water and phosphorus. Positive impact on the climate change without forgetting the animal welfare and a lower use of antibiotics. Reinforcing this point, a recent exhaustive studies review was published in July this year by Metex Nuvistago, a European amino acid producer. We can visualize on the charts the impact for poultry and swine of a crude protein reduction. These studies provide concrete information based on quantified research for making decisions for the livestock industry and policymakers. It's important to remind that governments and policymakers will have their role to play. A further reduction of the protein content in feed increases their cost, and then the cost of the end product, the meat, raising competitiveness issues in a world trade exchange situation. It means also that incentive programs may have to be put in place to accelerate the implementation. We start seeing some changes in Europe with the farm-to-fork strategy. It aims to reduce the contribution of livestock to climate change, to limit biodiversity loss and pollution, and lower the use of antibiotics and increase animal welfare. The Commission also wants to reduce the European Union's dependency on imported feed, such as soybean, which are, let's say, produced on deforested land, and promote the production of proteins grown in Europe, as well as alternative feeds such as insects, algae, or byproducts from the bioeconomy. Current discussion on the free trade agreement with the Mercosur region illustrates that reaching the farm-to-fork goals will require changes not only in agriculture and food policy, but also in how the EU, European Union, conduct international trade. A strong support from member states and national policymakers will also be vital, And today, some signals are still mixed. A last comment on technology, which are available and evolve quickly, is called PLF, Precision Livestock Farming. Both applications can be used by farmers to direct their attention to the individual animals. We can get everything on time on a screen and mobile application. Farmers can focus more time to preventing problems so that animals can be reared or can produce in a healthy and animal-friendly way. This technology can also support precise nutrition at every stage to feed animals and meet their daily requirements and optimize health management. For sure, it will never replace the role of the farmers. However, precise livestock farming make possible for farmers to allocate their valuable time more efficiently. Adisseo recently invested in PigChamp, CHAMP being the acronym for Computerized Health and Managing Program. I would not be complete if I do not tell you that beyond the product we propose, Adisseo also commit to reduce its impact on the environment per unit of manufactured product. Reduction of the greenhouse gas emission, reduction of the energy use, and switch when feasible to green energy, such as solar power source, and reduction of water consumption by optimizing our production process. So we have clear goal and a significant reduction by 2025, and this is part of our global sustainable program. To conclude, Adisseo aims to contribute to a sustainable growth, but we are not hopefully alone. Many companies in the feed industry, many feed additive suppliers, and for sure our customers are also driving their company towards the goals laid down by the United Nations. And it gives us some hope to feed the world in a more sustainable way and reduce the impact on the environment and climate change for the future. Thank you very much for your attention. Goodbye.